about whether a 1.5 is singular or plural. So I decided to cut myself some slack and add firefighters to the mix. Okay, so let's just begin. This is a joint work with Ohad. And let's just begin with playing the game. Then I'll explain why is it good and what can we say. So we have a fire. The fire starts here. And we have the Cartesian grid. So every point has its 8 neighbors. And every turn we get, the fire spreads to every adjacent unprotected vertex, square. And forgive me for not drawing here the grid itself, but I try to draw it straight enough for the points, for the grid to be clear. So the fire spreads to every adjacent unprotected vertex, and we get some amount of firefighters which we can place on vertices, on unburnt vertices, in order to protect them. So let's say if we have at least 8 firefighters per turn, every round, then okay, we can just surround the fire in the first turn, and now the fire cannot spread any further, and we're happy. Okay, so this was with 8. Let's say we only have 7. So we do just about the same. The fire spreads here. And now we can, with 3 more firefighters, we have 7, but 3 more firefighters, we still can contain the fire. Okay, so 7 is also good.
So
what happens?
Yeah, per turn,
and they stay there. They don't go anywhere else, and they just stay there. What I want to do is just to control the fire, to make it not be able to spread any further.
And the fire is adversarial or random?
The fire? No, the fire is deterministic. It spreads to every place it can. Okay, so we said 8 is good, 7 is good. 6 is also enough. If we start here, then maybe we begin like this, and then the fire goes here and here. Remember that we're playing here with 8 connectivities, so the fire goes here, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, we just are able to contain it. How long can we go? So we can do it with 5, we can do it with 4. Let's try to do it with 4, just to get the idea how difficult it gets. So we do something like this, and then the fire spreads. And then let's maintain this border and go here. And then the fire spreads again. And now we continue maintaining this and trying every time to get a bit further here. So we get this. It's quite easy to see that at some point we will win, right? This grows, but not that fast. And once we get here, we're almost done. Right, we just have to close one line. Okay, now you can see that in a few more turns, I'll win. Okay, this took me, I don't know, if I'm doing it like this, maybe it took me 9 turns to get there. If I'm doing it smartly, it takes less time, but how low can we get? Obviously, 1 firefighter doesn't seem to cut it. 2 also. Well, you know the answer, so... It's a bit, but the idea is this, even if I got somehow I got the fire, I got this free start, and the fire is somewhere here, and I got this free start. Now if I get 2 firefighters per turn, I can never even close this bottle. The fire will spread once I do something which is not like this, the fire will spread out and spill out of the... So even if I get this head start, on two on just enough to hold this. Let's make a formal argument why this is true. So I'll show now that with two firefighters per turn, we cannot even hold against, not on the entire grid, but only in the half, on the half plane, we cannot hold. So we have here some line, and the fire starts here. Even if the fire starts like this, we get two per turn. So the fire spreads, I don't know, somewhere. We have some firefighters, some points. And let's look on the topmost, the topmost row, which the, yeah, the topmost burning row. So here we have some burning vertices, and they have at least, now here I have one burning vertex, it has three neighbors here. Yeah, maybe it's not that easy to see. And even if I have, two, I have four. I have two extra neighbors on this row than the. Obviously, if I have, if this part is not contiguous, then I have even more. But I have at least two new neighbors in the next level.
What do you mean new neighbors?
So these are not burnt yet. And if I have, I don't know, if I have k burning vertices on this level, which is the topmost burning one, then on this I have at least k plus 2.
Okay. Hmm? Maybe
somebody blocked them in some earlier round. Yeah, so they, maybe I was smart and invested some time to block them in previous rounds, but to make this, if I was smart enough to block this earlier, or maybe I'm using now my firefighters to block this, in any case, I have to have at least, let's say, until this time, begin with one. Every time it grows by at least two. And even if you decide how you want to place your firefighters after we got here, just decide how you want to place them, then all you have is two times the height, and this grows by two every time. Yeah?
So what you're saying is, look at just the rows, okay? Look at the
just the rows, sorry, or the columns?
Just the columns, sorry. Look at, call a column blocked if it contains at least one firefighter, anywhere in the column.
Okay.
Call a column lit if it contains at least one fire.
Okay. But why are you doing with this with columns?
Well, so I want to say, so the invariant is that there's always one more lit column than blocked column.
Well, in the paper, which you can read if you want, we define a potential which is very similar. I will show the proof later. The proof for the three firefighters not enough, not the two firefighters,
yeah.
And then we're actually doing it with some potential. But here I'm trying just to get the idea that since you have two more neighbors every time, even if the number of every time you have two more neighbors, then you have to have at least. If you have only two more firefighters per turn, they're just able to cancel this effect of two extra burnt, of the fire front is growing by two every time, and you can only use two firefighters to make it not grow, but it cannot help you to diminish it, the fire.
Okay, but you are saying that this is not a formal proof now, or it's just the intuition, or do you...
So you can prove this formally by induction. Every time, once you get to, if you got here, then the number of and the number of firefighter you placed in these until time t is at most 2t, then the number of neighbors that you have in the next row is non-zero. You have at least the number of it always grows by two, and even if you invest some in the future, once you gather it grows enough for these to be insignificant. Still, you'll get.
So the claim that you prove by induction is what? That in time t, you have in height t, t plus one or something?
So what I'm proving is that the number of vertices that are about to be burnt, just because they are not protected, and I got the fire got near them, is positive.
This is by induction or by
you need
potential.
A stronger inductive claim, right? Because otherwise it could be positive, but there are firefighters everywhere on the next row already.
Right. That's the difference.
Yeah.
That's positive. The difference between those two. So maybe going to get burned, the number of firefighters still unused below them.
Yeah. I'll prove it more formally in the that will appear in the proof. I'm just trying to say that the intuition here is that we get extra two firefighters per. Okay, so now that we get what the problem is, maybe I'll tell you just a bit about it. So you don't have to consider this only on the grid or on this particular grid. You can consider this also on the four connected grid, the four regular, and on other graphs, maybe the finite graphs. And the problem was posed by Bert Hartnell in 95. I won't go over all previous results, but mostly they say something. So the lower bound was something like this, that you need more than two. And the upper bound, so we saw that four is enough. And actually, less than four is enough. So how can less than four be enough when three are not enough? You don't have to have the same amount of firefighters per turn. So let's say you have some function that says on each round you get some specific number of firefighters. Maybe the function is periodic, you get four, and then you get three, and then you get four, and then you get three, or something like this. And actually, it can be shown that that as long as it's more than you have more than three, and by this I don't mean just in the beginning you get one extra. So let's say it's a periodic function, and you get every m turns you get four, and then you get three for the rest of the time. So you can actually still block the fire. The idea is very similar to this. You just slowly advance until you're able to hold. Maybe I'll show this later if there's time. Okay, and this is also here we said that we begin in one source. So also if the fire is a bit larger, maybe there are a finite number of sources, then still you can hold against the fire, just because you use your first turns to somehow. Once you get to the point when you can do this, when you have your initial wall of firefighters, then you're good. Okay. So let's.
Always to have at least three firefighters, or is it okay that you have two one term and five the other terms?
So first of all, I can just think. Let's say first I get the five and then I get the three. Okay, so I can think that I have actually four and three. I'm just delaying it.
Two and five.
And if I get two and five, and so let's just say that on the first turn nobody does nothing. Anything. So I let the fire a free round, so it grows a bit more, and then it's still a finite number of sources. but now I'm playing the 5-2. Actually, I have these two extra firefighters which I can play somewhere. I don't mind that. This is one of the good things. I don't mind. In the beginning, I have some ball of finite size. I don't really care what happened until this point. And now I get, let's say, somehow more than 3 per.
You're saying that for any ball at the beginning and any periodic function with average strictly bigger than 3, you are okay.
Yeah, so this is basically where it was before we started working. Okay, so we want to take this intuition of 2 is not enough and to prove that 3 actually is not enough. So we said 3 plus epsilon is okay and we want to show that 3 is not okay. Here we used only one direction. So let's try to do this on all direction at once. And now I'll get it a bit more formal, so you'd be happy with my induction hypothesis. So let's begin with some definitions. So we have here the initial structure. We have some burning points. Let's say we began with 0 and the fire somehow spread, I don't know, like this, and we have some firefighters at several points. This is not necessarily a good way to play or even a legal way to play, but let's say we got to this or something. So I want to measure. This is my 0. I want to measure to define this line as I defined it before. So let's look on this line. Here we have it goes to the center of the vertices. So this is the lowest line on which no vertex is on fire. Okay, and similarly I have this one. Yeah, it goes to the middle of this, and this one. And this one. I don't care about firefighters, I only care about the fire. Okay, so let's say this line is plus 2, and this line is minus 3, and this line is minus 2, and this line is also plus 3. So I can, I have here some bounding box, and it has width and height 5. Obviously, they can be different.
So the numbers are.
So this is just the sum of these, right? I prefer to. So this is the line x equals 3, and this is the line minus x equals 3. Minus x equals 2. Yeah, and same here with y. So this is my bounding box. And I have the length of this front and the length of this front are both the height of the box. Now I have to say something about firefighters, right? I only have fire here. So I want to measure how many points, how many vertices will be burnt in the next step. Let's say now it's the fire's turn. So the number of endangered points, and when I say endangered, I mean actually doomed, so, since they don't have any chance. So these points are all going to get burnt in the next step. So let's define this as the potential of the state. Yeah. This is not the points on the border. Points on the border adjacent to a burning. So this is a number of vertices adjacent to fire. On the fire fronts. So the fire fronts are these lines. And unprotected vertices. Okay, this is the potential, and I can divide it into, this is the sum of the northern potential, the western potential, and like this. With the corners, I just say that this point belongs to two fire fronts. So it, if, for example, if, yeah. So this point, which is just about to be burnt, say it counts as half here and half here. It doesn't really matter. Okay, so you said this is the sum of have all four directions. And let us also think of the length of the fire front. So I already said we only have two numbers here, the width and the height, but we'll say, we'll denote them by these letters. So rho n is the length of this front. This is this and this are both the width, and this and this are both equal, and they are the height. So one thing that I can always say, obviously, let's use this board for this. So always I have that the number of burnt in some direction that are endangered is at most the length of this fire front. Why? Just because I can, the best thing that I can is just burn everything here. I can't get further than this. So this is one thing I'm holding. Okay. Now let's think about what happened in this case. So we were, in all of these cases, we were able to hold the fire. So we just held one front frozen. We didn't allow the fire to advance. And at the end, we didn't allow any of the fronts to advance. So let's say that the fire front is active in direction D. If this, I didn't denote this by numbers, but let's call these the. So let's think of this as a radii. So we have here this one would be the radius of the eastern front, and this one of the western, and this is the radius of the southern, and the radius of the northern front. So perhaps you think this is a square, but I see it as a circle. So this is just a radius from this point to this point. Okay, and this grows with time, right? If the fire front advances, then it grows by one. If the fire front does not advance, it does not grow. So this is exactly what I'm saying here. It is active if at time t plus one, it is not the same as in time t. It is frozen otherwise. And another thing that we can clearly say, that and let's also just denote this the difference here. This is an indicator variable that tells us if the fire has advanced or not. So it's either zero or one, right? Either it advanced by one or it did not advance. And we can say that the potential of some direction is zero if and only if. So this was one thing. This is the second claim that we have. If and only if it is not active. Why? This is the number of points that are going to get burned. If something is going to be burnt, we advance. If not, we don't advance. Okay, so we have this. And what happens if we sum all these indicators that tell us how many times the specific fire front has advanced? So this we get just the radius. So we'll use it just about now. So let's see what were our first non-trivial, only slightly non-trivial claim would be.
Use is defined with respect to the initial, to the beginning of the fire.
So what?
This definition of the radius.
So the radius begins with at zero and it grows. The radius is with respect to the single fire source at the origin. Okay, so what we can say now, I want to show that this is similar to what the induction claim was supposed to be. So how does the potential grow? Let's say we have the potential at point time t plus 1. I want to show that it is at least what the potential was a bit before plus 2. But this is only true. So I would like to say something like this. This is similar to what we said about the line. Every vertex has having, or every fire front having, two more neighbors than what it had. But this is not entirely true. First of all, if the fire front does not advance, then we don't get this. If we're totally blocked, we don't get this. So this here we only have, this only is true if the front is active. This is one thing. And the other thing, that there are these pesky firefighters that stop the fire from advancing. So every firefighter can only, let's denote this by f of t. This is the number of firefighters placed until time t to stop this fire front. So every firefighter can only diminish this number by one. It just blocks one point.
Are you assuming that this FD of T?
No, I'm not assuming anything. You placed a zillion firefighters, then you're allowed to make the potential go down by a zillion.
I don't understand exactly what you mean by FD of T. What direction does it contribute to?
Okay, so when I place a firefighter, the question is when...
the question is what is the definition of FD of T? So maybe it's the number of firefighters placed on level D up to time T.
Yeah, but don't want to count if the fire front is frozen. I don't want to count them every time. I want to count them only the first time. And if I want to count the firefighters only in the direction that is relevant to it.
Into the upper right corner, like in your picture, you've got your...
You have a picture?
Yeah. Above
this one? Or you want to...
I want it even further. I want it just diagonally up a little bit.
Here?
Yeah, I want to put it there. So
okay.
What does that contribute to?
So now I don't care. I'm waiting for the fire to arrive. If the fire is going... If at some point we're going to get, something like this, and the fire arrives from here, then now it's the... Now it's the northern front. Maybe if...
So you're only going to count firefighters actually placed on the front.
So I'm only going to count them when they are relevant. Maybe you place them earlier, but you put them, say, far away place. So I only count here. Maybe we say it like this. This is not... Yeah, so maybe we say that FD of T is the number of firefighters placed placed on this file front D. And since the file front moves, then I'm looking at the file front at time t. So the file front moves. At the beginning, it started somewhere low, and only when it gets, when the file front gets up enough to be here, then I'm counting this one.
You're saying it's the number of firefighters placed up until time t on the direction d fire front defined at time t.
Yeah.
And that upper, that diagonal corner counts as width?
Half. If it belongs to two, it counts as half. Yeah.
I'm actually not sure I understand the definition of.
No. Sorry. Let's just find this.
Okay. Fire front in direction D up to time T.
Yeah.
Do we care where? So in exactly the fire front.
So the fire front. The fire front. Where? But here it. This is the file front, only this part. Okay, it moves, maybe later it will move to be this part. So I only care about, at time t, I have these, five squares, these five vertices, and I'm only counting what is placed on these.
How many firefighters are placed here up to time t?
Yeah, and if I already counted them before, because the fire front was frozen, then I don't want to count them again. It wouldn't be fair.
Okay, so you count them only, so if d of t is...
Only the first time they are counted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Something is placed on the line, the top line.
Yeah. So what do you mean placed? Firefighter or fire?
Firefighter is placed on the top line, let's say mob is the left.
Here?
Yes.
Okay.
No, fire. On fire like this.
Yeah.
And then the fire reaches it like this. So then you count
it. When? Fire grows like this?
Yes. So
okay.
You won't count it.
I only will count it once the fire gets here and actually was in danger in this point unless the firefighter was there.
Okay.
So only when the fire reaches this point, then I'm looking at this line, and now the firefighter went. Now this point is on the northern front, and it's actually half of it on the northern front and half of it on the western front. And now I count half of this firefighter here and half here. Up until this point, it did not happen. Okay, great. So now we almost know what this means. This doesn't really matter because I'm just about to sum over all directions and over time, so it's not really important, but I'm glad we made this right.
Okay, so each firefighter is counted at most once for each direction over all time, is that correct?
Yeah, well, there's no point of counting it more than once. If it saves a point, you can't hold the credit forever. It has to... Yeah. Okay, so what we're saying here is that if the fire front is active, then we get two more, the potential grows by two minus all obstacles placed. And if not, then this is zero. This is zero. This is obviously true. The potential is always positive. It's a number of points. Okay, this now we can sum. You can sum this for t going from 0 to from tau's going from 0 to some point. So we get that.
This inequality holds if the fire front is active.
No. So this is also true when it's not active. When it's not active, here I have 0, and here I have 0, and here I have something which is non-positive. And here, this is some number which is non-negative. I'm okay with this. Well, actually, if the fire front is not active, so this would also be zero just because I'm not counting them again. But in any case, this cannot be positive minus something. Okay, summing this. So here we have a stereoscopic sum. So this cancels out. All in all, we get something like this. So at time t, it's at least what we had at time zero. So maybe we'll say that this is some constant, some quarter, whatever, plus twice the radius of this direction. So minus the number of firefighters placed on this direction at all times. So just the sum of all FD over time t. So all firefighters placed up to time t on fire front in this direction at any given time. Great. So this will take here. We have it here. So this is, let's say that this is one quarter. So in the beginning, we have potential of zero, which is 1 point. This is just the initial burning point. It is at time zero, nothing is, board is empty. And I'm just about to ignite the fire. So we have quarter here. It doesn't really matter, just a constant. So we have plus twice the radius, minus the firefighters. Okay, let's play with this a bit more. So now that we got this, up until now I did not limit the number of firefighters at all. So maybe you got a zillion of them. So now let's prove two things that only hold if the number of firefighters, the total number of firefighters placed until time t, so now it's the total, let's say this is at most, half of the perimeter. So the perimeter is just the sum of all these. So this is twice the width plus twice the height. So I can also write here, this is width plus height. And conveniently, this is just the sum of the all radii. Right? When I sum all radii, I just get the width ones and the height ones. This is just the half perimeter. So let's assume this is right. Obviously, for this to hold, this only holds if the perimeter is growing. So if the perimeter is growing, then the fire is already, we are not able to contain it. It will seem that we have a cycle in our logic, but I hope we don't. I'll point out where I think we solve this. So now we assume this for time t. And let's see what we can get. So first of all, let's try to sum this one for all possible directions. So I get the total potential at time t. And this is at most, I don't know, 1 plus twice the sum of radii minus the total number of firefighters placed. OK, but I know that this is at most half of the perimeter. OK, so I can say that this means that and this here we have the full perimeter. This is just the full perimeter. So we can just say that this is all of this. We have at least this is greater than half of the perimeter. So half of the perimeter cancels this. And I'm left with half of the perimeter. Let's just think for a second what we're saying here. the potential, the number of firefighters, or the, sorry, the number of points that are going to get burnt right now is more than half of the perimeter. So the first thing that we get immediately that we cannot control two adjacent, we cannot control three fire fronts or four fire fronts, obviously. We cannot even control two adjacent fire fronts just because of this. If we have, we have two adjacent fire fronts and they're only the ones that are active, so if they're not active, they're not contributing anything to the potential. And if they're active, so if the two of them are adjacent, so I just get half of the perimeter. And if I have more potential than half of the perimeter, then this cannot be. But you, you can ask, okay, so maybe somehow your bounding box is not very, doesn't look like a square. So maybe the only active fire fronts are this one and this one for some reason. And these are long enough for you to get more than half of the perimeter. So the question is how did they get to this stupid situation? Because somehow I managed to block only these small ones, only the small, the short fire front, and I didn't, it seems that as though I didn't do it in a very smart way. So let's see that this does not happen. So I want to show that it cannot be that of the two, of these two fire fronts, the two opposite fire fronts, they cannot both be frozen at the same time. Still, I'm assuming this. So, yeah. This one, this is something that we assume, and here we assume again. So let's say that the potential of the northern and the southern fire fronts together is positive. This is just saying they cannot be both non-active at the same time. Okay. So how would you show a time t? How would we show this? So we can divide, we want to use our favorite claim here for directions north and south. But first, we have to divide to two cases. So we want to look at these two options. One of these is irrelevant. If you're here, then it already doesn't matter, because it cannot be that these two together are the only ones that are active. This is just what we said when the two of them are adjacent. So if we have that the length of these two is more than this, if this is less than half of the perimeter, this is one case, and the other case is when the others get half of the perimeter. Okay, so these are the only two possible cases, because the sum of all of these two is the entire perimeter. So not sure how, it's quite easy, so I'll show it even though you all seem to be sleeping, just because it's short. So in this case, we just say that, actually let's keep this. You can try the and see this if you want to, if you want to see this, just you just get it from this one and this one, just applying some algebra. And the important.
So what's the claim? The claim is that in both cases.
Yeah, it doesn't matter if you take if northern or in southern or just western and eastern, the two opposite fire fronts cannot be both frozen, assuming this happens. This is just playing with the equations here, and the important thing that happens that we rely on is the fact that the perimeter is not only the sum of the length, and it's also the sum of the radii twice. This works out everything. Okay, so now I prove these two claims. One, that this cannot both be active, both be frozen at the same time, and this says that two adjacent cannot be frozen at the same time. Why am I done? Why is the proof done? So let's do the final induction, and you'll see how I'm not cheating you even a bit. The trouble is that I have these assumptions. Yeah. So let's make it straight. What do I have to assume first, and what do I have to assume after, to get everything working? So we're now proving that the proposition here says that if the number of firefighters we get per turn is at most 3. So I don't even care about getting it exactly. I just don't want to exceed 3t at any time. Obviously, this means that per turn you cannot get more than 3, but maybe in the beginning you got fewer, and then you get more. So if this happens, then so if this happens for all t, then the perimeter expands. So it is at least 6 times t for all t. This would also say that since the perimeter expands, the fire is never contained. The bounding box always grows, cannot hold the fire with only 3 firefighters per turn. So this this would mean we're done with the proof. So how does this work? In the beginning, this is true. The perimeter in the beginning is 0, and we're happy, and time 0. And even after one turn, we have that the perimeter is 4. It doesn't really matter how you place the firefighters. The perimeter is 4, and the perimeter is 8. We have two at each side. It's 8. We're okay. It's more than 6. So if this is true, then we have that f star of t is at most the semi-perimeter for a specific t. We're trying to prove this by induction on t. At t equals 0, it's OK. We assume it's for some t. We want to show it for the next t. So we know that for this t, it is OK. We have that the number of firefighters placed until this point is only at most half of the perimeter. We can apply both of these and get, here we get two firefighters that are adjacent cannot be both frozen at the same time. Here we get the same thing about if they're opposite. We cannot have less than 3 active firefighters. This is what we get here. If we had less than 3, then either we have 2 adjacent or 2 opposite. So this means that in the next step, what we have, how does the perimeter grow? Bless you. For every, this is where we use something. The perimeter grows at the next step just by, this is exactly how it grows. Each one of the radii grows by 1 if this firefront is active. So if 3 are active, then we get plus 1 here, plus, actually, I think 2. We have, we have 2 here. Yeah, because this one contributes both to this and this. Okay, so if we have that at least three firephones are active, so we get at least plus six, so we're okay also for the next turn. Yeah, so this bearing some technical detail here, this concludes the proof. And you may ask, we may ask when is the talk done, but in a few minutes. You may ask what happens now. So okay, in this case we know that it is 3 and 3 is not okay, 3 plus epsilon is okay. If you're playing not on the strong grid, on this 8 connected grid, but on the regular Cartesian grid, everything is just about the same, but the numbers that you get are different. So 1.5 is not enough, and 1.5 plus epsilon is not enough. Why is the difference? So basically, when we're playing here, then in order to the fire is able to advance in a diagonal fashion. So the fire grows that way diagonally if we don't block it. But the firefighters need in order to make a diagonal line, they need to go like this. So they're going in the L1 norm, and the fire goes in the L infinity norm. And in the Cartesian grid, it's just the opposite. We are able to block diagonally, but the fire is only grows in L1. So this is why is the difference. You could also think what happens if the norms are equal. So this happens in the hexagonal grid, for example, and then the answer is 2. So it is here we have 1 plus 2 or 1 plus 1/2, and 1 plus 1 is what happens when the norms are equal. You could also think about what happens in other dimensions. So in dimension 1, this is not very interesting. You can always use 2 firefighters to block everything. In dimensions 3 or more, then the problem is that your surface is growing too fast. If you only get a constant number per turn, so you only have a linear number of firefighters, but the surface grows quadratically. So maybe if you get, let's say, if you get 1,000 firefighters in the beginning and you only have a small ball, you're able to encompass it immediately. But once you get to the point where it goes faster, then even 100 firefighters won't help you to extinguish the fire. So I have to explain this for the non-Hebrew speaker. There's a song called 100 firefighters are not able to extinguish me in Hebrew. So yeah. Anyway. So this means that in higher dimension, unless you are willing to get more than a constant number per turn, it is not very interesting. You could also think, and Had and I were thinking quite a bit about the non-discrete case, about the continuous case, where we're trying the fire is growing as a ball, and we're trying to encompass it with some line whose length is not to grow over some function of the time. So sadly, in the real world, everything is more difficult, just because pi is not pi, the ratio between the circumference and the perimeters and the circumference and the radius and the diameter is not 2, sadly. So this should change some of the constants, and it actually makes us work a bit. If someone would like to speak with us about it, it would be nice. And what else can I say? So I could try to convince you that this problem is related to, this is a model of how some epidemic spreads and you're able to vaccinate only a specific number of people every turn, and this is very important, but I felt I have to convince myself that this is actually relevant. But I can show you that our work has had some effect so far. So can you please turn on the, so yeah, and with this we'll conclude. So the screen is not really important, just maybe just a projector, and have to do something with this. And yeah, ooh. Yeah. So you see that there's been a decline in the salaries of firefighters here, and we worked on this in April, and we published about here. So as you can see, this firefighters should thank us just because you need more firefighters. It shows that they are important, and they got paid more. So I didn't invent this. I just Googled firefighter salary, and got this. Yeah. So thank you.